Hi, and welcome to Shush the Talk Show. Did you know that when you watch the ads that pre-roll in completion before the episode, it helps us generate funding for our show? If you like what we do and you'd like to support us, please subscribe and share the channel with everyone you know. You can also continue learning about the subjects that we discuss by reading our column in the Sunday morning newspaper.
And the topic is abortion.
Oh my God, there are women who can't conceive, and why are you doing this?
I think my body thought that I actually delivered. I had breast milk.
Oh, you know, what does the law say about the man?
You're bad that you had premarital sex. That
if we legalized abortion, it would allow promiscuous women to sort of run wild.
I don't know which side to bat on, right?
If men could get pregnant, it would be legal.
Yeah, this.
Sure, talk about the taboos and all that. I will struggle. Today, we're going to have what you call a real taboo. And this is because this is an uncomfortable conversation for a lot of people in Sri Lanka. I want to thank Spa Global for being a location sponsor for the shoot today. I think today's topic needed a space where it's all about relax, chill out, feel comfortable. Interestingly enough, they have this little shisha area that we're seated at outside. So while somebody is getting their feet massaged in there, we're having a nice chat here. And the topic is abortion. It's a difficult topic to talk about. And there are probably people now watching the show going, rush their daughters out of the room or something like that because Sanskriti and culture and religion and all of that. Prabodhini comes from a legal background. And she's someone who has had a voice and uses that voice and her knowledge to write and to speak on matters pertaining to women's rights. Deepthi is someone who has had the experience of a termination, right?
So I was pregnant 5 years ago. I grew up in Germany and I was on a holiday, 6 months traveling trip here in Sri Lanka, and I had a relationship, and it's all
with a Sri Lankan,
with a German guy.
Okay.
And our relationship broke apart, and so I was in a very difficult psychologically weird state. So which is why I did kind of stupid things as well, I have to admit. So
no?
I was facing.
I want to stop you there.
Okay, okay.
And I know I don't want to sound like a preacher, but I really don't. I think a lot of women, they put themselves down when they go through challenges in life, saying, I did something stupid, I did something silly, and there's a lot of self-blame.
Yeah.
You're human.
Yeah.
What happened, happened. Yeah. It happens to so many people. It doesn't mean you consciously said, I'm going to be stupid and do something stupid. So don't call yourself stupid. Please.
Okay, thanks. So we broke up, and this person was absolutely not an option to be together with, to be a father. There were drugs and different things also involved around him and all. I was a student at that time also, so it was difficult for me because I was in Sri Lanka with my relatives. I tried to hide this, but then I had a very bad early pregnancy vomiting sickness.
Right. The morning sickness.
Morning sickness. So I had to inform my punchies, and they were really supportive. I thought they wouldn't be like this, but it was amazing how my aunties, like the women work together and all. So I got information about these several nursing homes here around Sri Lanka, which I don't want to mention any names and any places because it is illegal in Sri Lanka. So which is why I flew back to Germany and I have done it there. It's legal and
so you terminated the pregnancy. Okay, so when you were my knowledge, right, when you were looking for information here on where you can get it done and all that, like you mentioned, like it's illegal in Sri Lanka, right? So was it easy for you to find resources, or
but maybe I was not so much informed. So I mean, some aunties or some elderly women told me about some dodgy hidden places.
And did you go to those places?
I didn't go to those places because she told me, Deepthi, you are like, you're not married. They may look bad upon you. You are not with a husband or something. You are, oh my God. Yeah. So, and I don't know the hygienic procedures and all these things. We don't know. Yeah.
What scared you about it here? It was because nobody knew what they were talking about? Or?
No, it is just because it's you are being you're being seen as a woman, like I've experienced like that you are being seen as a woman, that you're bad, that you had premarital sex, that you, all these things, what this patriarchal society here in Sri Lanka, which is just...
Yeah, according to our society, we don't have sex at all.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, we are all virgins, exactly.
Actually, what they have found is that most women who come for abortions are actually married.
Oh, right.
Yeah.
Okay.
So,
and that is in Sri
90%,
Lanka?
90%, yes, in Sri Lanka.
So, you mean they're documenting the women who come for abortions?
They are, so, the medical community actually does a lot of work on this. So, okay. Because for them, and it's interesting when she said shame, and then you spoke about rights, because abortion in Sri Lanka has so many, like, faces, you know, for the doctors, for the gynecologists, it's a public health problem. And for normal women, it's a rights issue, right? And for society, it's taboo. It's like, you know, your religion, God will never... I'm not being sort
no,
of
no,
whatever,
no.
right?
It's perfect,
but it's about,
space,
yeah.
Like
because, the, you know, I read somewhere that the Catholic Church here has said that life is sacred. And when God gives, he gives. And when he takes, he takes. So you can't mess with it. And then in Buddhism, it's about abhinsa and you don't hurt people. And then the pro-life looks at the fetus as a life. So it has so many faces. But the people who documented it, unfortunately, is the medical fraternity.
Mm-hmm.
They have, in a way, it's good because at least
because
we have some
look
information.
Because it as a clinical, factual, biological thing.
Yeah,
right?
For
isn't
them.
That also, in a way, good because there isn't like the whole emotional and religious aspect of it in there. So it's factual. Whatever it is, it's factual.
So they have, and what they said was that in about 2018 or so, 17, it was about 700 plus abortions every 1,000 births. So that's a lot.
Yeah.
And then the third cause of deaths from moms was abortion, 12.5, I think it was. So, but funnily now they say that it's actually reducing.
Mm.
Because as she was saying earlier, the procedures were invasive, it was surgical procedures, and now there is actually a tablet, which you take, it's four tablets you get, 150 rupees each, you take it in two doses, so two tablets each,
okay.
And then it's considered...
So are those legal, if there are tablets
there's a small, available? There is a catch there, it's legal and it's not legal. So you could get it in the hospitals because it's used for post-birth bleeding, for hemorrhaging.
Okay.
But you can, but it's also a tablet that's taken for abortion worldwide. But in Sri Lanka, it's not licensed for that. So our pharmacists can't sell it.
Mm.
But you can find it in pharmacies and they sell it for safe clients. So it depends on your relationship with the pharmacist. It depends on your relationship with your medical personnel, you know. So, and also it's economic also. I mean, 150 rupees, yes. But also, what are the chances of some rural pharmacy having it?
Mm-hmm.
And so what do those women do? You know, there's a problem with access to safe abortions, where even the tablet, there are issues because you could die from bleeding.
Yeah.
And then we come to the criminal aspect. Because it's criminal, women who suffer from of going through abortions which are not legal in this country, then don't go to hospitals for care because they are scared. Because the law says whether you cause a miscarriage or whether you are a mom who or a woman who was involved in causing the miscarriage, you're equally liable. So it's 3 years with or without a fine for causing a miscarriage, and if you're quick with child, as in if the child has started moving, it's up to 7 years for the medical personnel and the mother. So that's
I actually read again, because I'm clueless about it, I'm hoping you'll be able to enlighten me, but I read that and I've had a few friends who have been able to, they say, legally terminate pregnancies because of medical reasons. But that's okay.
That's okay. The law is only if it is going to be dangerous to the mother. No other reason. So
so you mean it's not dangerous to the mother if she's like a young girl who got raped and got pregnant? It's not dangerous if she's living with some man who like says he'll beat her up if she has the baby?
This is the thing in our so this also brings it to that rights perspective, because it's not providing for safe abortions actually is a violation of your right to be free from torture.
And because one, unsafe abortions, you risk death, huh? Because you know, septicemia, then bleeding, all of that. Two is, as you say, you could be going through so much of mental agony because because your husband would be like, go do it, abort this, but how are you going to do it? It's illegal.
It doesn't even necessarily have to be a husband because there's so much other. And then the other thing is that if you're not married and if it's a young girl who, okay, consensual sex, gets pregnant, has to go through with it and has the baby for the rest of her life. Yeah. The way society damages her, not the fact that nobody supports her in raising that child, even though everybody says
have the child,
that's the right way to do it. If she does the right thing by society, then again she has to go through that whole thing of everybody just going, oh, there's the one who you know got pregnant without marrying and all of that.
The problem with abortion is women themselves, right, are so anti-abortion. If you speak for abortion, it's like, oh my God, there are women who can't conceive and why are you doing this? No, you have to separate the issue because you are in a place in your life when you're not willing to make that change, because having a child is, you get a completely different life. And maybe at that stage in your life, you don't want that different life. And then what do? You have to have an option to control your life. You know, it's very simply that. Nobody does that to the man. When I was talking to her, she said, you know, what does the law say about the man? And I was thinking, no, the person, I thought she was talking about the medical personnel, right? Okay. So I was like, so he's also liable. No, I'm talking about the father. Ah, good point. Even I didn't think about it because nobody talks about the father. Mm-hmm. It's about the woman.
Yeah.
I mean, and you have to grow that fetus to the child. If your body, if you don't want your body to go through that process, you shouldn't be forced to do it. Religion shouldn't do it, state shouldn't do it, society shouldn't do it.
Yeah. Okay. So, agreed. Obviously, she makes a lot of sense. Having children is never something that I have wanted to do. That said, were I to have conceived in whatever situation, I honestly don't know what I would do. And I'm a feminist. I'm all about, you know, women's agency and our right to our bodies, our right to choice and all that. And there's a lot of me that fights for pro-choice. But if it happened to me, honest to God, I don't know what I would do. I would like really struggle simply because, again, the whole, maybe it's the Catholic guilt, maybe it's that feeling of, oh, it's a life kind of thing, you know, maybe I'd struggle. Even though I wouldn't want to be a mother, I'd have like massive like shit panic attacks, and I don't know what I would do. So I can just imagine how difficult a choice it is. A lot of us in society, it's very easy for us to like look at somebody and feel like, oh, this is such an easy thing for her to do, she's heartless, she's cruel, she has no morals, she has no values.
That's what women, that is what women go through abortion.
How dare she kind of thing. But I don't think we realize the kind of
lots of the after kind of effects,
journey that she has to go through, that struggle.
I was always using contraception, like condoms, I didn't use the pill, so I was always careful in my life. But there's this one goodbye breakup scene, what you ever call
without,
it?
Without precaution.
Yeah, with crying and all that. And this is, I don't know, some God thing happened to me. So I didn't know. It's like this, I still love this child. I didn't decide against that child, but my decision at that point was against the man. Because he was horrible. So, and I didn't want to have to do this, like, even if I would have gotten the child, to explain the child about this father, that he might want to have contact with the father, like, and then I would have been in contact with this idiot for my entire life. So this was, I couldn't handle this at all.
Can you tell me about the process itself?
Yes.
Yeah, the procedure.
So in Germany, it works like this. There are if you are pregnant and if you want to terminate it, you there are three categories you fall into it. You can't just go somewhere and get it done. This is also illegal. So there's a legal process. You either category one is the criminal act if you have been raped and all that. Yeah. Category two is the medical, the healthy aspect if you the mother is in risk and also if the baby is in risk. So both sides, what you mentioned before, like
And fetal abnormalities.
Yeah. Exactly. And category three is like you have to, if you still, if you don't belong to these two categories, there's a social service approved by the government. You have to go there. It's like a consultation session for 2-3 hours. It is written. You have to like, you get a certificate. You get a 2-hour like counseling service, information about what kind of termination they are available, what will happen to your body, very medically explained and also from an emotional point supportive. And with that certificate, you have 3 days time and only after 3 days you can go to a doctor who's doing it or to like, they have abortion kind of clinics where you can go and with that certificate and the approval of your doctor that you're pregnant, like the ultrasound. Only after this talk, you can go there and then you can get it done, termination. Okay. So I didn't feel any pain, nothing. I was just falling asleep. And when I woke up, I was lying in a nice room. There were three other girls next to me who just did it, had the termination.
Did you experience any hormonal issues or anything afterwards? Were you fine? Did you have any medical complications?
No, it was I was bleeding. You bleed for some days. Also after normal pregnancy you bleed. Yeah. like a period sort of thing. And I was of course crying. Yeah, I was very sad and all that hormonal thing. I think my body thought that I actually delivered, because after 2 weeks I had breast milk.
Oh, okay.
And I asked my doctor, oh my God, is this normal? And she said, actually, after like, I was just in my 10th week, this is not so common, this happens, but it was like a very, I don't know, in my case, I had proper, like.
Oh, right. Yeah. Okay.
So I was like, okay. So that was hardcore.
I've not heard of that before. I don't know. So I'm just trying to put myself into that space of, my God, like what a girl can go through. And then I asked myself, like, what would I do with all my big talk and with my whole, sure, talk about the taboos and all that. I would struggle because I would feel like I don't have anyone to talk to. I wouldn't know what to do because you're worried about your image, you're worried about all sorts of things, because this country has just like brought us up to
brainwashed. So one of the things that they found out when they did research was that a majority of the women who've had the unwanted pregnancies did it exactly for the reasons that you said. Most of them religious, because of the religious upbringing, they felt this was a sin and they can't terminate this pregnancy. And the others were about the fact that society, their families would look badly upon them if they terminated this pregnancy. But nobody actually was prevented or was hesitant to go through a termination because it was illegal. So they would still go to the quacks. They would still subject themselves to probably these deathly procedures to terminate a pregnancy, because you know this is such a basic fundamental need for a woman. I mean, and nobody seems to understand this. And so it would be very, because when you mentioned about the patriarchal society, I don't know whether I'm taking the conversation out of context, but it was really interesting you said that, because a public parliamentary debate said if we legalized abortion, it would allow promiscuous women to sort of run wild and, you know, have sex whenever they want.
I want to ask about that. Actually, no. I do worry, like, yes, young girls or any woman, it doesn't even have to be young girl, right? Anyone who doesn't want a child should have the right to say, I don't want a child. But then do you also, I'm just asking, right, if it's okay, termination is all right, does it also set a precedent for people being very casual and dismissive about the whole process of conception and childbirth, that it becomes like something that they don't take responsibility for how, you know, promiscuous they are, or for understanding the gravity of terminating a pregnancy on moral grounds, or or just, you know, that whole process of, we teach kids about safe sex. We don't teach kids about safe
we
sex.
Don't, in this country, no, sex
we don't.
There's no sex
education. That is where we. Yeah. But without getting that part of our education right, where we are not teaching kids about respect for your body, respect for life, which is, I mean, you can't say that respecting life is a bad thing, right?
Yeah.
Having some value for life and all that is, I don't know if you can say that's a bad thing, but then as much as we're moral about, we get all righteous indignant about the woman terminating, but when we allow it to happen also, that we are encouraging them to disrespect life in that sense.
I don't think legalizing abortion would cause this supposed promiscuity, because you see, if you look at the statistics about the statutory rape business, right, which is in Sri Lanka, if you have intercourse below 16 years, whether with consent or not, it's statutory rape. So it's a bit like abortion, other side of abortion, right? So the man is responsible. Yeah. Whether the girl consented or not, the man is, okay, you committed statutory, you go inside, you are behind. So what they realized was that a lot of these under 16, they will have this entire relationship. And as long as no adult in the village finds out, it's fine. But the moment they find out, especially the girl's parents, and then the girl gets scared, no, I was raped, right? So what do you know, and is abortion then the answer to that? Probably not. It's probably sex education. So we kind of come back to that whole thing there, right?
So to legalize abortion, you cannot do this just alone in Sri Lanka.
Exactly.
You're legalizing abortion and sex education.
It has to go hand in hand.
I think that's sex education, if at all, needs to come before. Then you won't have these cases of unwanted pregnancy unless it's a case
of rape
or whatever.
But the entire, the face of wanting to terminate a pregnancy really is also incest, rape and fetal abnormalities. And to even get that passed, it's so difficult. In 2017, there was the Alvihari committee which looked at this, and they said, okay, legalize abortion for statutory rape, that is girls who get pregnant under 16 years of age, for fetal abnormalities, severe fetal abnormalities, incest and rape. And even that, you know, the entire sort of the religious community, the Catholic community, the priests, the parliament, they were like, no. There is a problem now that women in the rural areas, you forget about abortion, will you, are not being given family planning because it's entirely Muslim issue. Mm-hmm. So they say, you go and have another child and come, we'll tie the tubes for you. So then those people, what do they have to resort to? Abortion.
As a society, when we are not giving women the access to choose how their future and how they would raise children or whether they would raise children or not, we are not giving them the right to decide, then we are putting them into a bigger problem. And I say this because I don't know which side to bat on right now, because I'm so angry with society for what it's doing to women. And at the same time, I'm in this moral dilemma of, isn't the fetal right also
there's no right and wrong?
No, but scientifically also it's so divided, because to this day they have not been able to find out whether life forms at the point of insemination or is it after 2 weeks, is it after 3 weeks. So where life begins or what at what point is it life is still debated. So do we then on this debated issue and allow morality and religious perceptions and religious dictates take over the life of a woman? And in the end, as you very correctly said, it's not only the woman. You bring up children who have no proper access to education, who have not been brought up properly, who are malnourished, who are frustrated with life, who are angry. They become part of society. They become drug dealers, drug addicts, prostitutes, you know, the entire thing, right? So that entire thing, then another sub-issue that gets created by this whole thing.
But if we want to be pro-life, then we have to create a system that supports that pro-life narrative. Mm. So if you're, say, for instance, if you're going to bring up women to believe that if there is a pregnancy, for whatever reason, if it's not endangering her life medically, that she needs to have the child, then society, the government, all of us, we need to have systems in place to support her. If we are saying you have to have the baby, you cannot abort, then if she doesn't abort, we can't run her down into the ground and make her feel like bad and depressed and mentally all that. And a lot of girls get suicidal also when they're given that choice. Sometimes they kill themselves before they kill the child in them because they can't live with the that moral dilemma that we have created in their heads.
I have an issue, sorry, with that because I feel that's very utopian. Yeah. Because no state can
saying,
create
because it's
that.
Utopian only, yeah. I'm saying therefore, mm-hmm. ergo,
yeah.
perhaps we should be a little more realistic,
conciliatory, and
practical about.
And a state should not, I mean, a state really is secular. It should not have any form of religious intervention. And for women, this whole business of abortion is almost criminal, yes,
yeah.
and sort of sinful and all that is because it's attached to motherhood, no?
Mm-hmm.
And they know, you know, and the problem is with motherhood, you have to be ready for it. You can force a woman to have a child. You say, let's say, utopian, you also have a system that takes care of the child. You still to breastfeed the child.
And you have to go to 9 months pregnancy,
yeah.
to birth. You have to. My sister just got a baby. She's a 3 months old baby. This is so much work.
And then
is unbelievable.
And who takes care of postpartum depression after that?
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, and then you carry the child through 9 months. You breastfeed the child, say, for 1 week. And you give the child. There is still an issue there.
It's not having a bonic kind.
Yeah, exactly. Now then it's a proper life. It's a human being. It's a child. Then you form an emotional attachment. And scientifically they prove that breastfeeding a child is, say you formula feed, you take the child immediately. And then you go through that. And cesarean is also not elective, no, here. It's elective if you have money.
Yeah.
So you go through that entire process of labor, maybe for a day, 2 days. And you give birth to the child and the child is taken away from you. Then what about the emotional trauma there? The problem is only women need it, no, not the men, no.
So if men could get pregnant, it would be legal. Not
yeah,
legal
this is why it's because
I read that. Yeah, actually, if men
it's specific
got pregnant,
to the men, no. So nobody seems to understand. You can go and sign all the international conventions in the world that says give women health care, and all. No, you don't really need to. Who's going to push it? Nobody, no, really.
What I can say to women is that there's this one thing you have to get out of your head is guilt. Like, because you are being full of guilt that you are a murderer, that you are a killer, and no, you are not a murderer, and you are not a killer. And because things happen in life for whatever reason, for whatever situation, sometimes you cannot just be a mother that's in this time. So the post effect, there's another one called grief. Like, I think you should, like, if someone dies, you have a funeral, right? So with your lost baby, you can also do certain things.
Grief.
Like you can, like I wrote a letter after some months, yeah. So I explained her, I don't know, I just knew that it was a girl, maybe it's some, I don't know. So I explained why this happened, who was your father, who was me, what kind of situation I was in. So I wrote a long emotional letter and I kept it for some months and at some point I was burning it with a friend and I made a ritual out of it and put it into a lake.
So it helped you?
Yeah, it helped me a lot. So there are various ways of how you can say goodbye, but I think a woman, not only the woman, also maybe the male partner was also sad about it. Actually, there are many men also who are very sad that their girlfriend had an abortion, or maybe they didn't know actually that their affair or girlfriend were pregnant and they found out years later, hey, I was pregnant by you. You know, there's so many things are happening. So there are also men who are very, very sad. I met many men actually also who told me about this. Like in Germany, I met many open-minded men who were.
So just before we started shooting the episode, I actually Googled Sri Lanka abortion, right? Just to brush up on, okay, what do we need? And there is a list of places that comes up calling themselves abortion clinics.
Oh, really?
But if it's illegal, how is that possible? Like, how can they publicize the fact that they are abortion clinics?
Anything is possible. the one that was really doing the proper job was Mari Stopes. And that was shut
down.
But
that was shut down. There was like huge cases around that.
Yeah.
Right?
So the others are all quack places. No, I mean, they probably function. They do something. And
but aren't they worried about being found out and all that? I guess that they have some sort of
immunity. This is why I say it functions, it happens, and this is also why it needs to be regulated, because they will turn a blind eye And the moment it's caught, okay, you get sent inside. That's not the right way to regulate, no. And obviously, then the law is not doing. The law is anyway not doing its job. If the idea to criminalize it is then to stop abortions from happening, that's not happening, no. As you say, there are clinics also.
Yeah.
And then there are problems in how good those clinics are. Mm. What kind of methods they use. You see, I really hope that I'm not taken out of context, because having a child is a wonderful thing, right? But you have to have the child when you're ready. Otherwise, it's just, it is also a virtual prison. Exactly. This is why I can see people coming on to me saying, you've had the luxury, you were lucky. You know, there are women who are suffering, who are struggling to be pregnant, and how can you now promote killing a life? No, I'm not promoting killing a life. And I'm not saying motherhood is, but it's amazing, it's really good. But it's a struggle. And you have to be mentally and honestly, physically and financially prepared for that struggle. Otherwise, it's going to be very, we say you keep this community together, keep this unit together. I'm talking about married people, right? But having an unwanted pregnancy in the end might just end up ruining that entire family.
Legally, in the case of rape, isn't there a caveat or a loophole in the law that allows a termination of pregnancy if it's rape? Because she didn't get pregnant consent.
That's what they've been since 1995. They've been trying to legalize abortion for something as common, like it's common sense and basic as rape, incest. Who would want to carry that? You know, which child wants to be the child of an uncle and a niece or father and who would want to be that? Incest, rape, but no, the, even
and it's very it's very easy for us to say a child, but then we are not raising that child.
Yeah, exactly.
We are not doing our bit to, yeah.
Can I say something to this?
Sure.
No, especially in Sri Lankan society, there's no sex education, so many girls, especially in rural areas, they don't have even their own rights to their own sexuality, masturbation and all these things. So they're just there for the pleasure of the man. So how can they say, "Ane, don't do it." And then the men, all these men say, "Mang atle to daane," like, "I take it out." Or, come on, you know what I mean? Like, so many men forcing also pregnancies. It's not always the woman, "I won't have wild sex," and just doesn't care about pregnancy.
Yeah.
But there's so much not knowing things, and also not having the right as a woman. I don't want to have sex. I've met so many rural women. They say, "Yeah, we have to do it. I'm the wife, I have to spread my legs for my husband." Imagine.
No, thank you for saying that, because I think that's also, because when I listened in on all these social media conversations and all around these abortions and all that, there's a lot of moral indignancy that comes out. Oh, so she shouldn't have sex then. She should have just kept her legs together in that case if she didn't want to get pregnant.
So he should have maybe used a condom. He should have not ejaculated inside her even.
And also,
both sides.
Can you tell a woman? Nobody tells a man, no, you shouldn't have sex then?
Yeah.
If she wants, she could have sex. The point is, you should provide for her health care and you should provide for her to exercise her rights.
But sometimes it's not about her having kept her
this
legs
is
together.
True.
Sometimes
this,
it's about her legs being forced apart by someone else.
Exactly.
Thank you for saying that. But my thing is, actually, if you are engaged in sexual behavior, if you have a boyfriend, even if you have a husband, if you don't have a boyfriend and you're into like multiple partners, it's fine, but take the precautions, because one mistake, all it takes is one time, right?
No, I mean, of course, like you said, there should be legal possibilities, but which I took in Germany, but of course, it's not a game. You should not play around with getting pregnant and, let's get pregnant and have an abortion every 2 months. Of course not. But even that is not even, I don't have a right to tell this a woman as well. If she wants to do it, it's her life. I cannot say, you know what I mean? So, but
I don't think women do that. That's an option they take. You know, if they would want to go for safe sex. And that's why, 74% of women practice traditional safe sex, which is what they know.
Honestly, to most women I spoke who have gone through an abortion, like, I think maybe 8, I don't know, my numbers may not be 100% correct, but I think 80% or 90% just did it because, not against the child, because of situation and difficulties. Seriously, it's not all these evil women, they hate their babies,
this
they want
kids.
This is not at all like this.
Not at all, yeah. And I don't think it's...
I don't think any of us has the right to decide or determine what the state of that mother's emotional state is, or what she's going through, or why she aborted her pregnancy. I don't think it's for any of us to have a say on that. It's entirely
a personal, private.
Personal. I must also talk about the fact that, you know, there are instances where differently abled pregnancies, for instance, if it's a woman with suffering from Down syndrome, or a woman with autism, or it can be a woman who doesn't have the necessary facility to raise a child, like physically or mentally, and if they don't have a support system to raise that child. I mean, it's not to say that people with Down syndrome shouldn't be allowed to have sex, because it is a biological thing. They are allowed to experience sexual pleasure if they want to. We can't stop them from doing that. But at the same time, if there is a pregnancy, then there needs to be a conversation that we need to have, like, what is going to happen? Chances of them passing down that gene is there very high. If there is a sort of a medical issue like that. Otherwise, there needs to be systems to help.
Yeah, because one of the arguments that these pro-life people bring for fetal abnormality abortions is, already the law and society discriminates disabled or differently abled. So by at the initial stage terminating it, you're kind of making it okay. No, you don't make it okay. You do two things. One is what is that person's quality of life? As you say, if the society, if state can provide for all of that, it's fine. But we are having so much of difficulty putting the ramps, for the wheelchairs in, I mean, places of public access. So let's not go any further than that. So if you can provide for all of that, that is okay. But where we cannot provide for it, at least for that timing, we should allow for that part of termination of a pregnancy, elective, of course, if the mother wants, for fetal abnormal. Nobody says, no, if it's abnormal, if you have to go and do it.
Porn is also another contributor to, you were saying, bad sexual choices, right? This whole thing about not using a condom, the excitement of not using contraceptives, or
and the lack of the choice, because sometimes the husband says, no, I don't want to use a condom, or the partner, the boyfriend, or one time, or whatever. I don't want to use it because they say the pleasure is more, whatever.
So many men say,
and then, what is the choice a woman has, what is she going to get up and go?
Yeah, the women here are kind of submissive, and the porn industry promotes that also, and it's very female degrading. It's like the dominate male who's dominating the sex life of the woman. So if boys watch porns from a young age, they think this is sex. A woman gets one thing here and one thing here, and this is like, oh yeah, this is what a woman wants, and no condom and nothing, and sperm everywhere. So this is, this disgusting sex.
And it can be sex. So I do think if you have a pregnancy that you feel is unwanted right now, not that I'm saying keep the baby, it'll be great if you are able to, I guess, because there are girls who do get abortions who later regret. That's happened too, because they did this, but then they beat themselves up, and that's in their head, because again, the moral, whatever complications, and they hate themselves, they blame themselves, and that is also not healthy, to live your life feeling like that. Then they get very anxious about, what have they done to their own bodies. So I think when you are in a situation that you have a pregnancy that you're reconsidering, you should be talking to somebody, and I think you should be talking to a counselor, because they're very open, they're very neutral, they're able to guide you to decide whether this is actually the right thing for you, or whether it's like a harsh, quick snap judgment that you're making. Never say never also. Maybe I'm being devil's advocate, but never say never. There could be an opportunity for your pregnancy to go through, and you might end up being relieved that you didn't terminate. I wanted this episode to be a case of you can disagree to, or you can agree to disagree.
Sure.
You can come from different views, points of view. End of the day, each individual, each human being has a right to their own autonomy and
how they want to live their life.
Life is not easy everywhere, whether it's abortion or whether it's something else. Choices are tough. So I think because choices are tough and because things like abortion are stuff that we will think about and we will struggle with as a society and as humans, it is so important to talk about it.